Class 9, today we are going to start with the chapter If I Were You. So, if I want to ask you one question, just tell me that whenever you are facing any kind of problem, you are in a, you can say, you are in a situation where you don't know what to do. What is the first instinctive action that you would like to take? What you would do? No, you are not supposed to take. You are all alone, suppose, at home, and you are in such kind of condition that now either this side or that side. Okay, so at that moment, what will you do? What will you do? Nee, that I'm telling you to imagine yourself in the shoes of others, but how? What will you do? Suppose you are in that kind of situation. Okay, an intruder has entered your house and he is pointing at you with his gun, or you are at gunpoint, then to follow his orders. Okay, so this is one thing. Okay, suppose sometimes if a thief sneaks into your house and ultimately you are all alone at home, there is no choice. Many things, and many, you can say, these kind of happenings we daily listen around us. Okay, many kind of news are there daily circulated in newspapers and other channels, and in which what it is there, it is always explained that so and so robbery has been made in banks also, some bank, okay, in banks also, in ATMs also, many things are happening. But the what is the thing here in this story? A person, he has also come with that intention. Okay, the intruder has entered with an intention to kill the other person and take on his identity. But it is always the intelligence of the person who will take over the charge of the situation. Okay, so now very, you can say, the chapter is sort of, you can say, full of curiosity, full of surprise. And you will come to know at that, and I'm not going to let the cat out of the bag, that you will come to know what will happen at the last. No, this I'm not going to do. Let us read the chapter, and then slowly and gradually you will enjoy the sequence of events, and you will really enjoy what will happen in the end. So how it happens, and ultimately one important lesson that we are going to learn at the end of this chapter. So let us start with the chapter without wasting much time. Last two students, what's going on? And last, just Karan, close the notebooks, please. Close, I said. And just Karan, you come to that side, please. I'm not able to see you. So now, here starts the chapter. Jared lives alone in a lonely cottage. An intruder who is a criminal enters his cottage. He intends to murder Jared and take on his identity. Does he succeed? This I have already told you, that whether, let us see whether he will be able to succeed or not. Next, some of the phrases are given that we will do after completely reading the chapter. And now coming up to scene. Okay, so where it is set up. A small cottage interior. There is an entrance back right, which may be curtained. Curtain means curtains are there at the back. Another door to the left must be practical door. Practical door means which is often used for regular purpose. Sometimes in a room, there are two doors. One is usually remain shut, which is not often used. And the other one, which is always being a practical door, which is often used. The furniture is simple, consisting often of a small table towards the left, a chair or two, and a divan rather upstage on the right. So very simple setting of the room is described here. Furniture of very simple type. Okay, a small table on the left hand side. Okay, then what is there? Two chairs, one for the person who is living and one for the other, if anybody would intend to come, and a divan on the right hand side. On the table is a telephone. So here, why there is mention of telephone? Because this telephone is going to play an important role here. Okay, it is going to play an important role here. What are you doing? No, close it down. Concentrate upon the chapter. So telephone is going to play an important role here. When the curtain rises, Jared is standing by the table making a phone call. Just a moment, please. How many? 30? Now, when the curtain rises, Jared is standing by the table making a phone call. He's of medium height. So see here the explanation. You can, so that you can formulate the picture of the person in your mind. So this is exactly what the writer wants to display. Actually, he wants to create an image in your mind. How will you? It is through descriptive indicators here. Okay. So what are the descriptive indicators here of his, you can say, of his body as well as physique? It is given here. He's of medium height and wearing horn-rimmed glasses. Horn-rimmed glasses like this, okay? And he is dressed in a lawn suit and a great coat. Lawn suit, you understand? That is the long coat that one wears, okay? And a great coat. It means that he is trying to go somewhere. He's ready to go out. And his voice is cultured. Cultured means well-mannered. He is talking in a very mannerful way with the other person, or with the person on the other side of the phone. It means that he is not rough in nature. Okay, he is dealing with some profession. Now, so this is like, you can say, description of the person. So Jared, well, tell him to phone up directly. I must know. Yes, I expect I'll still be there. But you must not count on that. In about 10 minutes time, right ho, goodbye. It means that what he means, tell him to phone up directly. Means that when someone, he is calling to someone, that someone is sending another man. Okay? Okay, and he said that when he will come, tell him to make a call to me directly. It means he is wishing to meet someone. Okay, he is expecting someone to come. Okay, and he said, don't count these minutes, in about almost 10 minutes time and goodbye. He put down the receiver. So you will feel that this is only chunk of information. Why? Because you are not able to listen to the person on the other side of the phone. But from here, we have got plenty of information that what he is going to do. He is expecting someone and he is going out to meet someone. He puts down the phone and goes to the divan on the left where there is a traveling bag and starts packing. So on the table, there was a traveling bag and he started doing packing. Whilst he is thus engaged, another man, similar in build. This is very important here. Similar in build. So while he was performing this task of packing, another man from the door enters who was quite similar. Who was very much similar in build. Okay. Okay. Similar means he was as if Jared is standing in front of him. Okay. Who has completely taken the outlook of that person. He enters from the right silently. Revolver in hand. And what he was having? Revolver in his hand. He is flashily dressed in an overcoat and a soft hat. Okay. Round hat. Soft hat it is called as. Okay, so he was dressed up, okay, just like him, and he was wearing a soft hat. Why? In order to conceal his actual face. This is the purpose of this hat. He bumps accidentally against the table and the sound, Jared turns quickly. It means stealthily, without making any noise. He was trying to enter the room, but ultimately what happened? You know, this happens when we are very much careful. Then what happened? We try not to make any noise, but at that moment, definitely something hit us and we will make noise. This happens with him. He bumps against the table. And naturally, when a table is moved, little bit noise is made. And Jared, who was doing the packing, he looked back in this manner. Who's that? Now, Jared, naturally, he was so pleasant. He did not know the intentions of the person who has entered. Why? This is a surprise, Mr. Means he said, yes, of course, this is a surprise for me that you have come here. He did not know him. He did not know his name. Intruder, I'm glad you are pleased to see me. I don't think you will be pleased for long. Put those paws up. Okay, he said, now, finally, iron and all, last. Be quiet. So what he said, I'm glad, I'm happy that you are pleased to see me, but you will not be pleased for much long time when you will really come to know that why I have come here. And put those paws up means put your hands up. Jared, this is all very melodramatic. So here the word use of melodramatic. Okay, it is, you know, that this kind of word, it is related to that of plays, stories. It means that this is also telling us the indication of the profession of Jared. Okay, that he was a playwright. Okay, this is all very melodramatic, seems to be quite dramatic, not very original perhaps, but he was just thinking that this is just like a drama happening in front of him. But he said what actually it is, intruder, trying to become an, oh, he said, just calm down. Nonchalant is your word, I think. What is the meaning of nonchalant? Without any enthusiasm, of course, and without any interest. He said, without any enthusiasm, you have come here. Yeah, thanks a lot. You will soon stop being smart. I will make you crawl. I want to know a few things. He said, thank you very much for the compliment that you are giving me. But actually, it is very soon that you will forget all about these things. You will not pay much attention. And see, I have come to know a few things from you. And definitely that will not please you. Jared, anything you like. I know all the answers, but before we begin, I should like to change my position. You may be comfortable, but I am not. So see, till this moment, Jared does not know that what his intention was, why he has come to his house. Okay, so he thought that someone has entered. He is interested to seek any kind of information from him. But ultimately, why he has come here? Exact purpose is not known to Jared. Okay, so he said, okay, fine. If you want to know all the answers, I'm quite comfortable. I will provide you all the answers, but let me change my position, because he was standing. Okay, so he was standing and he said, let me have a comfortable seat. You may be comfortable, but he said, I am not. Actually, the thing is that he is taking time to think. So, intruder said, sit down there and no funny business. He said, okay, fine, sit down, but no more funny talks and conversation. He motions to a chair and seats himself on the divan by the bag. He sits there. Now then, we will have a nice little talk about yourself. Now we are going to start a short very talk about you only, that I want to know. Jared. At last, a sympathetic audience. Again, this is an, underline this, sympathetic audience. Again, this is an indication these words are telling about his profession. Audience word is always related to that of place. Okay, when something is being delivered on the stage. Sympathetic means sharing. No, it's like you can say understanding, listening. Okay. Finally, he thought that he sat like an audience and now he's going to listen to him. I'll tell you the story of my life. How as a child, I was stolen by the gypsies. And why at the age of 32, I find myself in my lonely Essex cottage. How? Essex is the name of the place. So he said, actually, I want to tell you about the story of my life. That during the young childhood, I was stolen by the gypsies. And now how? And now,
what is the meaning of gypsies?
Gypsies, you know, this is a tribal, you can say it's a tribal, you can say tribal people. Gypsies, you know, okay. Mainly they are from Africa. Okay, gypsies. But here in our country also, people who are moving from one place to another, they are not permanent residents of an area. They are also considered in this clan. They are also considered to be a part of this clan also. Okay, they are performing treks and earning their livelihood in this manner. Okay, so these are gypsies. He said, now he is going to tell about the reality of his last two students. Stand up, please, you both. Close those notebooks. I'm telling you again and again. Heaven, this is the problem. Then come to that side and on single desk. You also, that boy, you please come here. If you will not listen to the chapter, you won't be able to answer any question. So now, yes, now he's telling about the story of his life, that when he was a young child, he's telling the reality, but we are not sure whether what he's telling is absolute reality or not. There is no hint given in this chapter. Okay, so he said that I was stolen by gypsies, and now at age of 32, I'm just living all alone in this Essex cottage. Keep it to yourself and just answer my questions. You live here alone? Well, do you? He's not at all interested in what he's going to tell about himself. He said, no, I'm not at all interested in what you are saying. Actually, I want to know. Just tell me that, are you living all alone here? I'm sorry. I thought you were telling me, not asking me. A question of inflection. Your voice is unfamiliar. Inflection means rise and fall in the voice. Okay? So, your voice is unfamiliar. Jared is saying, are you telling me this thing? I'm living here alone, or you are asking me? Okay, so he is trying to indulge himself in conversation. Okay, with that intruder. And he said, actually, it is a question of inflection. Inflection, again, what it is telling? Where inflection is mainly used? In plays? In poem recitation? Okay? So he said, your voice is unfamiliar. Actually, I'm not getting the tone of your questions and answers. Now, intruder with emphasis said, do you live here alone? Now he's getting angry. And if I don't answer, intruder said, you have got enough sense not to want to get hurt. He said, if I don't answer, he said, I think you are intelligent enough that you should know that if you won't answer my questions, I'm definitely going to hurt you, and you know how to avoid it. I think good sense is shown more in the ability to avoid pain than in the mere desire to do so. What do you think, mister? Now again, see his answer. He said, I think it is better to avoid this kind of pain and never to indulge yourself in this. Intruder, never mind my name. I like yours better, Mr. Jared. What are your Christian names? Vincent Charles. Now he said, actually, you won't be interested in my name. Actually, I am quite more interested in your name. Actually, I know that you are Gerard, but what is your complete name? He said, Vincent Charles. Do you run a car? He said, no, that's a lie. You are not dealing with a fool. I'm as smart as you are smarter. And I know you run a car. Better be careful, wise guy. When he said no, he said, don't make a fool of me. I know you run a car. And I'm smarter than you. This is the reason why I have sneaked in, why I have come here. And be careful, because I'm going to kill you and I'm going to hurt you. Are you American, or is that merely a clever imitation? Now, the way he's speaking, his accent. He said, you are actually an American, or you are just imitating that accent? Intruder, listen. This gun's no toy. I can hurt you without killing you and still get my answers. Now he said, listen to me. Don't indulge me in your conversation, because I want the answers to my questions. And if you're not going to answer my questions, I'll definitely hurt you without killing you and will get the answer. So it's better that you will give the answers to my questions. Let us assume ourselves that we are facing this kind of situation. Then what? I don't think so that we won't be clever enough to talk with him in such a pleasant manner. Okay, and we won't be talking to him and we won't be conversating him. We would be rather afraid. So this is the thing that writer wants to display here. Of course, if you put it like that, I'll be glad to assist you. I do possess a car and it's in the garage around the corner. So what he said, okay, of course, if you say like that, but actually I want to tell you that I have a car and it's in the garage. That's better. Do people often come out here? People often come to meet you. Very rarely, surprisingly, few people take the trouble to visit me. There's the baker, the greengrocer, and there's the milkman, quite charming, but no one so interesting as yourself. He said, yes, of course, there are a number of people with whom I'm dealing. The greengrocer from whom he's purchasing the vegetables, the milkman, okay? But he said, no one is so interested in me knowing about me, like you are asking me. Greengrocer person who sells vegetables? No, I happen to know that you never see tradespeople, but actually he said, actually I come to know that you never meet these kind of business people, tradespeople who used to sell things. Jared, you seem to have taken a considerable amount of trouble. Since you know so much about me, won't you say something about yourself? You have been so modest. Now he said, you have really put yourself in trouble to know about me. You have collected good amount of information about me. You are also quite intelligent, but can you tell me about yourself also? I could tell you plenty. You think you are smart, but I am the top of the class round here. And I have got brains. I use them. That's how I have got where I have. He said, yes, definitely I will tell you a lot of things about myself, but don't ever think that you are smart. In the class of smart people, I'm always at the top. I'm the smartest of all. He said, I have brain, I'm intelligent enough, and this is the reason why I have come here. And where precisely have you got? It didn't require a great brain to break into my little cottage. And he said, please tell me that your brain, where has it has led you to come? That with your brain you have entered to my cottage. He said, it is not so difficult to enter my cottage, which is quite a simple one, making fun of him. But see his answer. When you know why I have broken into your little cottage, you will be surprised, and it won't be a pleasant surprise. So he said, this is not the thing. Here, intelligence doesn't lie in that I have entered your cottage. But the thing is that when you will come to know that why I have come to your cottage, it will definitely give you a surprise. And that would not be a pleasant surprise. He said pleasant surprise, but actually it won't be a pleasant one. With you figuring so largely in it, that is understandable. By the way, what particular line of crime do you embrace, or aren't you a specialist? He said that I now come little bit, I'm understanding that what you are going to tell me. But what particular line of crime? Are you a thief? Are you a robber? Are you a killer? Which particular line of crime? Are you a specialist in any line of action? My specialty is jewels robbery. He said that actually I am a jewel robber. And your car will do me a treat. It's certainly a dandy bus. Now, sort of you can say it will assist him. Okay. So he said that it will definitely be a treat for me. I'm afraid jewels are few and far between in the wilds of Essex. Gerard said, for jewels you have come here. I don't think so. You will find enough jewels here in Essex. So are the cops. I can retire here nicely for a little while. And he said, it is only the cops who are also looking for me. But I can here have, you can say, I can here be able to evade the police for some time and spend some time here. You mean to live with me? A little sudden, isn't it? You have not been invited. He said, it means you have come to live with me to avoid the police. But he said, I haven't invited you, but isn't it very short time that I don't know you and I will let you live with me? You won't be here so long. I didn't trouble to ask. He said, don't worry. you won't be staying here for much long. And I didn't take much, you can say, attention towards it to inform you. Jared said, what do you mean? This is your big surprise. I'm going to kill you. So he said, actually, my surprise for you is that I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill you. A little harsh, isn't it? Jared said, aren't you getting harsh that you have come to kill me? No. Yeah. I'll be sorry to do it. I have taken a fancy to you, but it's just got to be done. He said, finally, it's in my mind and it will definitely be done. Why add murder to your other crimes? It's a grave step you are taking, he said. You are a jewel robber and now adding crime to your list of crime. He said, it is really a very serious action that you are going to take. I'm not going to take it for fun. I have been hunted long enough. I'm wanted for murder already and they can't hang me twice. He said, don't worry about that. I'm clever enough, he said, actually, I have already murdered someone. Police is always looking after me. And if they will catch me, they can't hang me twice for two murders. They will give me punishment only once. You are planning a gratuitous double, so to speak. Admitted, you have nothing to lose, but what you have to gain. Now he said, very clever planning on your part. But please tell me, by killing me, what benefit you will get? I have got freedom to gain. As for myself, I'm a poor hunted rat. As Vincent Charles Jarrett, I'm free to go places, do nothing. I can eat well and sleep well and without having to be ready to beat it at the sight of a cop. So he said, it means by killing you, I'm going to live the life of yourself. That is Vincent Charles. No longer I will try to run from police. No longer I will hide myself. I will always enjoy my food, go around the places, and I want to live a peaceful life. In most melodramas, the villain is foolish enough to delay his killing long enough to be frustrated. You're much luckier. So he said, actually, in dramas, what is happening that villains, they are never, they are always lingering on this act of killing. But I don't think so you are doing this. Okay. So it means that the thing is that Jared was behaving in a quite relaxing manner. He is using his intelligence to get rid of this problem. Okay. So now, after that, in the next lecture, we will come to know how he was able to get rid of him by using only his wit. So this is the actual lesson that we are going to read, learn from this chapter.